यस मैम, वी आर लाइव ऑन अभी, सो आई एम मेकिंग मानसी मैम होस्ट। ओके मैम, यू हैव द राइट।
या आई गॉट इट।
ओके, गुड आफ्टरनून। गुड आफ्टरनून, आई एम डॉक्टर रुचा राजापुरकर फ्रॉम डीवाई पाटिल कॉलेज ऑफ फिजियोथेरेपी। वी वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर टुडेज वेबिनार व्हिच इज बीइंग कंडक्टेड बाय डॉक्टर मानसी सोंगिरकर बोराडे, who's completed her graduation from CMF College of Physiotherapy and has done her master's in musculoskeletal and manual therapy in Dr. D.Y. Patil College of Physiotherapy, Pune. She has done her certificate in myokinetic chain release and chiropractic master. She has worked in lead physiotherapy clinic for 1.5 years after pursuing master's. She has been appointed as a senior physiotherapist in charge of department in Ruby Hall, Hinjewadi for 3 years. Later, she chose to dedicate herself towards spine and ergonomics completely and is now heading a branch of clinics across Pune, which is named as 360 degree spine and rehabilitation from last 1.5 years. Also, she has a private setup spine and joint physiotherapy in Moshi, Pune. She passionately conducts ergonomics in corporate, industrial, and retail sector with her own brand, Solitis, Change for Better. She successfully conducted almost 40 plus lectures till now and aims for a lot more. We welcome you, Dr. Mansi. You can take over from now.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rucha. Can you hear me?
Yes, I do. I can hear you.
All right. I would like to thank you for this wonderful introduction. Thank you so much. I am so glad that I could represent myself in my own college platform. So my heartfelt gratitude towards D.Y. Patil College of Physiotherapy. I would like to thank Dr. Palekar sir, Rathi ma'am. She's always been pushing me, you, Gaurang sir, and Mayura ma'am. So I would start with my topic.
Sure.
I'll do the screen sharing.
Yeah.
Okay, can you see my screen? Yeah. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, we can. You can continue.
Okay, sir. Fine. So today my topic is non-surgical treatment of disc herniation, a new paradigm. Table of contents. So what we are going to discuss today is, you know, basic about the spine, the growing back pain epidemic, structures related to it, and degenerative disc disease and herniated disc disease, which are the major concern for me, main two concern for me, for my treatment rather. Then the objective outcomes. What are the objective outcomes? What
not
we need.
Yet, Dr. Manthi, we'll just wait for a second.
Okay.
Yes, it's there.
Do I start again or I continue?
You can start, Dr. Mansi.
Yeah.
Okay. So today we are going to discuss about the growing back pain epidemic, structures in brief, degenerative disc disease and herniated disc disease, the main two classifications, objective outcomes for it, treatment options, my new paradigm, which I'm going to talk the most on it, spine decompression and mobilization therapy, and further things related to it with case studies and references. So talking about the spine, now before I start, a disclaimer, I'm not here to talk good about my therapy and criticize my physiotherapy or something like that. So,
okay, you can start now.
Do I start now?
Yeah.
Do I restart or I continue from here ahead?
Continue, please.
All right. All right, so I'll continue. So I repeat that disclaimer. I am not here to compare my therapy with the fellow therapies. I found this therapy. I'm working on this therapy. And so I have got good results. And that's why I'm here to share my knowledge with you all. Starting with it, we'll just go through a brief of spine. You know, spine is a complex arrangement of bones composed of joints, muscles, ligaments, disc, and within it is your spinal cord and the exiting nerve roots. In the spine, all these are stacked together while allowing you in the free range of movement. Talking about the statistics, now these are the recent statistics which I have mentioned, though this is bound to change every month, every year rather. So these are psychological and financial. Spinal pains are psychological and financial burdens because they are, you know, millions are spent annually on this healthcare sector. 80% of the people, sometimes 60 to 90% of the people sometime in their life have back pain, neck pain, and most of them are related to what your bulging, protrusions, extrusion, which affects your exiting nerve root and the spinal canals as per severity, while the remaining 20 are related to facet joint, ligaments, lamina, and muscle strains. So this is a beautiful picture of a lateral view of a spine MRI I have got. This specifically I have mentioned talk about the disc. So if you see a disc between L2 and L3, the purple part is your annulus, and it is nicely well hydrated. Even the nucleus pulposus is light chrome colored. It is jelly kind of substance, well maintained. Between L3 and L4, the nucleus has lost its water jelly content. So it is discolored. And in the disc between L4 and L5, the annulus has degenerated. The annulus has also come out. If you see, there's a bulging disc between L4 and L5. So that is how it is. And even the nucleus has become in a darker shade. It has again lost its water content. And between L5 and S1, the annulus is completely torn and the nucleus is coming, bulging, popping out. It is extruded, it is frank extrusion. And it is compressing the exiting nerve roots. And on the other side, the right side picture is the image of a healthy disc and your degenerated disc. So talking about disc, consists of a nucleus, annulus, and cartilaginous end plates. Its nutrition is commenced through its end plates, of course, and it is controlled by sinovertebral nerves. Now, these are made up of collagen fibers, aggregates, and elastic fibers. So your disc has say like 70% of water and remaining is 30%. So it is so much hydrated part of your spine. On this basis, I have classified disc pathologies into two parts, degenerative disc disease and herniated disc disease. So talking about the first about this degenerative disc disease, it occurs depending on the aging process, very commonly seen in the old age spine. So depending on the aging process, what happens is your disc height reduces. This happens due to dehydration. Now dehydration causes what loss of osmotic pressure from the nucleus, because as I mentioned earlier, nucleus has more of water content. So this causes cells, disc cells nutrition. Now these cells, be it in the disc or in the body, they are all alike. Their basic need is nutrition like glucose and oxygen in order to be active. Now when there is dehydration, all this thing is shunted, it is stopped. So the disc height reduces. Another reason of disc degeneration is the excessive mechanical loading, age, improper metabolic movements, and your structural damages such as end plate fractures, then annular fractures, and so on. I won't go much in details about this. Just a brief about this further is the early changes that have been identified in the nucleus pulposus and annulus are probably biomechanical and related to the age. So any additional trauma is going to speed it up. When there is a discogenic injury, the physical displacement of this disc occurs, you know, the protrusion, extrusion, or bulging, so on. And then further, you land up into tissue edema, spasm, and the most important, intradiscal pressure increases. This restricts the fluid migration within. So plus, if it is added with, you know, compression injuries, like end plate fractures, this further predisposes the disc for degeneration in future. So alteration in any normal kinetics in the lower back is going to give you the pain and disc disruption, which is, you know, very important to maintain the homeostasis around the spinal disc. So Yong Heng and Kirkcaldy Wills correlated this degeneration clinical symptoms. They classified it into three stages. So the three stages are stage of dysfunction, stage of instability, and stage of stabilization. So in this function, what happens is, I don't have an X-ray or MRI screen for this. So just talking orally about it, even you would be able to relate. So there is a very little pathology. Even symptoms sometimes are there, sometimes are not. And you diagnose the patients as lumbago or a normal muscle strain and so on. Stage of instability comes when there are abnormal movement, motion segments, and instability is there. The patient complains of moderate symptoms. The findings, objective findings are also there, and it can be managed conservatively. And your last stage comes the stage of stabilization, where there are severe degenerative changes, the facets, the end plates, everything with reduced motions and gives you stenosis and symptoms which are unbearable, and conservative managements might not work in these cases. And so you have to, surgery sometimes indicated. The other type of disc is your herniated disc. So herniation or herniated intervertebral disc is a stimulation of spinal dura mater or nerve roots by leakage of nucleus pulposus caused by tear or degeneration of annulus fibrosis, resulting into the symptoms like lumbosacral pain radiating sometimes to the leg, buttock pain, pelvic pain, then muscle atrophy, paresthesias, limping gait, the most important limitation in severe limitation in functional activities and ADLs. So degenerative disc and herniated disc can occur same in one spine. They are interdependent. One can trigger another and vice versa. But for treatment purposes, we have classified them. Considering the earlier part is clear, I'll move towards the objective measures. So these are the very important objective measures which I can practice over here, for which I require MRI and X-ray. So there are three of them. The first one is herniation index. Now with herniation index, spinal disc herniation is measured on MRI and then compared pre-post the treatment to have an objective difference, so that even we can see it and even we can show it to the patients. The evaluation of the disc and foramen vertebrae is evaluated from longitudinal cross section. The sagittal distance of herniated disc is the maximum length of anteroposterior diameter, and the length of anteroposterior canal is the maximum length of the canal. So if you see the picture, the white part is the herniated part and the blue part is the normal part. So to simplify it more, AB is the maximum anteroposterior disc height, herniated disc height. CD is the width of herniated disc material at the level at the mid distance of AB. And the blue part is the normal, as in EF is the maximum anteroposterior canal and GH is the width of the spinal canal at the mid of EF. So to measure, now if you see the AB and CD part are mentioning the herniated disc. Now to calculate the herniated disc, the equation happens to be AB into CD divided by EF into HG into 1000. It is mentioned clearly in this picture, and that is how the herniation index is measured on the longitudinal cross section of MRI. Going on to the next parameter is your disc height. Now this can be taken on an X-ray also. So the disc height measurement was done by in 1999 and was measured in such a way that the space between two vertebrae is divided into three parts. Frontal disc height is the front, middle disc height, and the back part of the disc height, the posterior one. So the formula for this is A plus B plus C divided by 3, wherein A is the frontal disc height. If you see in the picture, B is the middle disc height, and C is the posterior disc height. And it is measured in mm. The third part is the disc degeneration grade. Now, these grades, of course, you have to see more clearly, more precisely. They are seen on MRI, but even X-ray can give a good value. So the grades are as follows. You see this grade system on T2 weighted images of MRI. So the disc classified as grade 1 shows a balanced structure of both a high strength, a wide single intensity, and a normal disc height. If you see in the left upper corner A picture, so you will see that there's a nice signal intensity and the disc height is also normal. The nucleus and annulus are also well defined. Second picture, there is again high strength white signal, but it has a non-uniform structure of annulus and nucleus. They are not so well defined, but the disc height is again maintained. I'm changing the slide. The next grade is where a gray signal intensity is seen now. There are non-uniform structures. Annulus is again not well defined from the nucleus. And if you see in the picture, the disc height is reduced a little posteriorly, but still things are well maintained. In four, what happens is, I mentioned the four already. In five, what happens is, there is non-uniform structure with dark signal intensity, no difference between nucleus and annulus, okay? And almost you see a black space, and the spaces are completely abutted. The last right corner picture. So this is how the disc degeneration is measured. So this is what is about the objective measures. Moving on to the major part, treatment options. So I'm going to basically talk about pharmaceuticals, shots, and the physiotherapeutic treatment. Surgical part I'm not going to talk about. Pharmaceuticals, it is a common practice in India to pop pills for back pain and neck pain. So commonly given medicines, prescribed drugs are NACIs, sorry for the spelling mistake, acetaminophens, and opioids. With epidural shots, epidural steroid injections are usually, given infused within the on the root block or the nerve, on the root or the nerve to have blocks, and it shows a significant but a short-term effect. Physiotherapeutic treatment, we are blessed with wide arrays of therapies. In electrotherapies, we have IFT tens, ultrasound, SWT, routine practice. And we have new advancements like PFMS, EMRT, matrix, magnetodyne therapy. Then exercise therapies form the major part, at least for me, it forms a major part of my program. A crisp spine rehab program is a way to achieve anything. Then are the spinal manipulations. And then there are specialized therapies like cupping therapy, dry needling therapy, instrument assisted soft tissue release, chiropractic, and osteopathy manipulations. So these were about the therapies. Now I'm going to discuss about a new paradigm, spine decompression mobilization therapy. So if you see the picture of the machine at the right side, so spine decompression mobilization therapy is a drug-free, non-surgical approach for managing acute to chronic spine issues, a new ray of advanced technology for us. So when I mentioned that it is a non-surgical and it treats acute to subacute to chronic conditions, doesn't mean that we have to give it to the every patient. Patient selection criteria is at most important. The objective measurements, which I mentioned already, has to be screened first. The patient is then categorized into grades and then chosen if he's really going to feel better with it. So patient selection criteria forms a major part of my treatment. Going further, this technique is delivered by highly motorized, computerized unit or a modality, if you see that gently decompresses the spine while aligning it through mobilization techniques. So decompression therapy is used to relieve pain and symptoms caused by nerve root irritation, and it is basically a simple act of lengthening of spine effectively. So it reduces your muscular spasm, reduces the pain by 30-40% initially. Now it penetrates beyond the muscular level until the disc level. To decompress the disc and remove the pressure, which is it is putting on the nerve roots, and it effectively reduces the pain and permanently because it works on the anatomic dysfunction. Talking about the mechanism of action, decompression is achieved by using a specific combination of spinal positioning and varying degrees with intensity and force, which is suitable for the patient. I will mention and I'll show you a video later on, which will show you a clear picture of it. Now the key to produce this decompression is a gentle pull that is created by a logarithmic curve. Now this curve is also seen on the system over there. So I'll talk about the curve in the next slide. So what happens is when the distractive forces are generated on the logarithmic curve, the typical proprioceptor response of that muscle spindle reflex arc is avoided. So that allows a decompression only at target area and not the traction. We will also discuss difference between decompression and traction. So first, going on to the decompression part, this is the logarithmic curve. So in this curve, if you see, it is a cascade pattern curve. If you see the first part of curve on the extreme left side, the curve goes up slowly in a cascade pattern. For example, if you apply a weight of 10 kgs, it starts from zero and it doesn't steep rise to 10 kgs. Or it even doesn't slowly rise to 10 kgs. It goes into step by step. For example, it will increase 2 kgs first, give a platform, even reduce little, and then increase to 3 kg, give a platform, again reduce, again increase to 4 kg, then 10, and slowly 10 in a cascade pattern. I repeat, this cascade pattern is very important. How it is different from traction pattern, I'll explain in the next slide. So with this curve, what happens is, as mentioned earlier, the proprioceptor's response is eliminated. So, So the proprioceptor response, when it is eliminated, it doesn't cause muscular contraction. When it doesn't cause muscular contraction, it doesn't activate the muscles. It doesn't put pressure on the disc. It doesn't increase the intradiscal pressure. Rather, it reduces the intradiscal pressure, the major part of the therapy. So, talking about the effects, decompression therapy creates a negative or vacuum pressure inside the disc. Since the affected level is chosen on the system, of course, after the clinical evaluation, and then effectively pulls the disc in the desired angles. Hence, from above, it is clear that for treatment efficacy, disc elongation is needed with at least 25 to 50% of patient's body weight. So that much pull is required to cause the disc separation. So so as to create the negative pressure, and that negative pressure has to go up to minus 150 to minus 200 mm of Hg. Further, the disc, now because of this negative pressure, because of this pulling thing, what happens is the disc shrinks inside and regains its regular shape. And it takes off the pressure which it is abutting on the nerve root or the origin of the nerve. So hence it reduces the pain and inflammation and you feel better. Now, affected disc is like a vascular necrotic tissue. So in order to nourish, now the first part I spoke about the negative pressure which is created, how it is created. Now the second part is rehydrating the disc. So how does the disc rehydration happens? Talking about the disc which is affected, as I mentioned that it is an avascular necrotic tissue. So nutrition of the nucleus or the disc happens through nucleus and happens through the capillaries that pass through centrum, which are transmitted through subchondral plates and stops at the cartilaginous end plates. Like all cells, as I mentioned earlier, that they require glucose and oxygen to survive, nutrient exchange is required. But because of this pathologies, it all gets stopped. So when you give a decompression, it stretches the wall of the disc. It stimulates the capillaries and regenerates the blood circulation. And that's how, again, the nutrient exchange is promoted. Slowly your disc starts rehydrating. The second effect. Third effect, especially when you have radiating pain. Now, this is, of course, due to disc herniation. When you develop neurological deficits when the disc is excessively sitting on the nerve root. So it causes ischemia of the mechanical factors like spinal nerves, the dorsal root ganglion, and the nerve root. So it is sitting. It is preventing the blood supply over there. But when disc separation happens, what happens is the intervertebral foramina increases. So it reduces the direct pressure and the contact forces on the sensitive nerve root area. Hence, normalization of the neurological deficit starts happening. So basically, increase in the intervertebral foramen, reduction in the pressure on the dorsal root ganglion or the spinal nerve, suppression of ectopic impulse generators, and normalization of nerve conductions. So this is the major effects of spinal decompression therapy. Now, mobilization part. Of course, the mobilization part combines with the decompression. It goes simultaneously. So decompression aided with mobilization, that is movement of spine. Basically, as a whole, it aligns the spine, improves the body mobility, and makes body ready for the exercises. There's a short video which I want to show. Okay, I believe this is not starting. No, just a second. Fine. The video which I was trying to share with you all to show you all is not working, unfortunately. I think there's a technical glitch. Alright, I believe that everyone is able to see my screen again. I'm sorry for the technical glitch.
Yeah, Mansi, you can start.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so this is what was decompression with mobilization. Now, usually whenever a patient comes to me or even with the other physios when we have discussions, they usually ask me this question. So what is the difference between this decompression and traction? The machine almost looks like same, not this one definitely. So what exactly it is? Isn't it better giving traction rather than, you know, making it using a high word like decompression? And so this is the most important part wherein there is a difference, how to explain that, what is the difference between traction and decompression. So many clinicians practicing in the field of spine issues have criticized traction therapy due to its less efficacy in providing the valuable effects. So basically, traction causes what? A muscular stretch receptors to fire. So when traction is basically muscle pull, so it stretches the muscle, activates the stretch reflex arc, fires the muscular receptors, causes the muscular contraction, increases the intradiscal pressure, and increases the pain and inflammation further. So this is the muscle spindle reflex arc, which I was talking about. And this is the graph, which you see first I'll talk about the continuous traction graph and then the intermittent traction graph. So on the left side, if you see continuous traction graph, if you put a weight of 10 kgs, there's a steep rise in the 10 kgs and then it reduces immediately, though slowly, but it goes straight 10 kgs and straight 0 kgs. So what happens is your muscle reflex arc gets activated, your muscle contracts, it puts pressure on the disc, the intradiscal pressure increases, further increases the pathologies. Intermittent traction was then taken over and it was helpful because it didn't increase the weight directly to 10 kgs. It slowly increased and then reduced. If you see the right graph pattern, right-sided pattern in the graph, there is a high force, low force, and the rest interval. But again, during the plateau phase here is very less, or rather when it starts from zero, it reaches 10 kgs with very less intervals. So yes, in this also your muscle, your stretch reflex arc gets activated. But what happens in decompression is, so basically decompression is an event, combination of restraint, angle position, and equipment engineering. So one can experience traction without decompression, but not decompression without traction. So that is the beauty. So if you see the graph, I have compared the decompression graph and the traction graph. So in decompression graph, you will always see a cascade pattern. Slowly increases, maintains the plateau, again reduces so that the muscle, the stretch reflex arc is not activated, the proprioceptors are not activated. And then it slowly reaches 10 kgs. And again, while coming down, cascade pattern. So there is no way of activating the proprioceptors. But in traction, as I mentioned earlier, muscle spindle reflex arc does get activated and the mishaps happen. So this is the basic difference between decompression and traction. So to gist it out, in decompression, left side is your decompression and right side is your traction. So with decompression, gradual stretch without firing the receptors, pressure applied at curve angle, monitors and adjusts the forces, stronger harness, and maintains the negative pressure. So basically, if it would have been seen in the video, there was a pelvic harness, which and the thoracic harness, which holds it tight and maintains the intradiscal pressure throughout the treatment value. Whereas traction on the other side causes abrupt muscle stretch due to receptor activation, sharp angle pressure, and it is not applicable, as in the monitor adjustments, everything is not available, and the counter pressure is given, but it is not sufficient. So this was about the decompression and mobilization therapy. I'll go ahead with the inclusion criteria. So who are my patients? I already mentioned, but to further gist it out, patients who have pain due to herniated and bulging lumbar disc that is more than 4 weeks old, recurrent pain from a failed back surgery that is more than 6 months old, persistent pain from degenerated disc not responding to 4 weeks of therapy, patients available for 4 weeks of treatment protocol, this is more important, and patient at least 18 years plus. So indications are as follows: herniated, protruding, bulging disc, nerve compressions, lumbar disorders, injury to the lumbar nerve root, lumbar strains, instability, stenosis, degenerative disc disorders, spinal arthritis, and facet syndrome, disuse atrophy, acute, subacute, chronic sciatica back pains, post-surgical low back pain. I also treat post-surgical low back pain, but they shouldn't have any instrumentations done. Even failed surgery, again, without instrumentations. Any patients who's advised for surgery but not willing for it, numbness, tingling in the upper or lower extremity, and radiculopathy who have failed conventional therapy. Now, patients who are advised for surgery but not willing for it, just because they are not willing for it doesn't mean that we take them for the therapy. Criteria, screening, evaluation is very important. Choosing the patient is important. Contraindications, a lot of them, but then again, they might be relative sometime. Severe nerve damage or tethering from scarring, severe obesity, more than moderate osteoporosis, pregnant women. I have given one to a pregnant woman. I had an MRI as well of her, but still it's a relative contraindication because the pelvic harnesses and thoracic harnesses are tight. Plus the mobilization happens with decompression. Spinal surgery with instrumentations, as I mentioned earlier, recent spinal fractures, L1 compression fracture without neurological deficit, I have treated after post 9 months, after complete healing. But there was no change in the framework of the L1. The latter part, which was giving her pain, was treated with it. Infection of spine, metastatic cancer, spondylolisthesis with past defect. It is unstable. So no, you cannot take that. Pathological aortic aneurysm, cancers, infections, peripheral neuropathies, because of course they are not related to the actual problem. Hemiplegia, paraplegia, cognitive dysfunctions, and recent fractures, which I mentioned. So this is the last part of my study, presentation. Case studies. So this case study I have not done. This I have got it from a paper. The latter case studies are mine. So talking about this case study, this guy was 36 years old, 76 kgs, and he had diagnosed L5 S1 herniated disc on the MRI. The MRI screens here are not much clear, but in the next screen it is pretty clear. So for this particular patient, we had given a 6-week program, wherein in first 2 weeks we gave 6 sessions a week, then in second week we gave 4 sessions each of 45 minutes, and then out of 6 weeks the last 2 weeks we gave 3 sessions a week, and then there was a 6 week of follow-up. The follow-up was, say, like 2-3 follow-ups a week, not more than that. So with this protocol, you see in the right side in the table, the VAS was 6 and it reduced to 2 in this many sessions. And these are the MRI changes. So if you see on the left MRI, beautiful is seen over here, but then not actually beautiful for the patient. A nice big disc is coming out. And if you see in the post X-ray, in the post MRI film on the right side, it is almost negligible. There's a section view also comparing very clearly. I have marked it into red colors. So that's a beautiful change. And this MRI was taken after 6 months. minimum 4 to 6 months after the MRA changes are seen. This was my study. I couldn't get a X-ray or study. I couldn't get an MRI of this patient because the patient himself had come with, if you see in the left picture, patient had come with a severe list and he was not even able to bend 1 degree. He had excruciating pain. After 20 sessions, the X-ray changes were not so significant. I could only see the photo changes. So after 15-20 sessions, this was almost, I say, about after 15 sessions, later on he improved well. His back is completely normal. The list is of course gone. And whatever functional limitations he had were all tackled. Now this is another study which I had done. This is a MRI of he was almost 78 years. Yes, and he had pain in back, neck, lumbar region, radiculopathy upper limb, radiculopathy lower limb. So see the right side of the MRI screen. That is pre-treatment. The spinal cord, especially at the thoracic region, is abutted completely. There is no single intensity seen over there in the lateral view. So that is how severe his bulges were. And he had a severe sclerotic margins. If you see, there is a disc dehydrations as well. But now if you see the left side of the MRI screen, I had taken this after 9 months because the patient had severe. The patient didn't come for 9 months. He had taken almost 28 to 30 sessions. So after 9 months, if you see, the spinal cord has regained its way towards the end of the end of the spine, and even the sclerotic margins. If you, I am unable to zoom and show it to over here, but if you see the white part, that is the sclerotic margins have also been improved. That is extra calcification which has happened. It's a product of healing, and even the rehydration of disc has happened to a certain level. So the patient had a very beautiful results post almost 2 months. So this was a study done. These are the research studies along with the references from where the material I have taken. These are the another research studies and the context with the references. And here I'm almost done. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mansi. It was really a wonderful session with, short and crisp presentations and with, yes, very informative case studies.
Thank
you so much. I thank the organizers of this alumni group. So I would request the participants to stay tuned with us for tomorrow's presentation by Dr. Sagar Mahajan on ergonomics for repetitive strain injuries, its assessment and solutions. So tomorrow will be the same timing at 3:30 p.m. I thank Mansi a lot. Thank you,
Dr. Mulinda. Thank you everyone for staying throughout 1 hour, and I'm really glad you all made it here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Mansi, you just have to turn it off. Leave the meeting.
Okay. Just a second, Dr. Madhula, I believe.
If you can see, end meeting over there as you are a host.
I have, unfortunately. Can you remove me out of the meeting? I have a technical glitch over here, I believe.
No, you are the host, so you have to.
Okay, yeah.
End meeting. Hello. हेलो
मैम, आई थिंक हैंग झाला त्यांचं.
एंड करते मैं.
या एंड करूंगा. ओके.